I wanted it to be a nod to the late 50s and 60s and 70s and that artwork era, but I also wanted to create my own world within the artwork. What's up, everybody? It's Fred Sands the Fourth, designer and art director, and I'm here to give you an inside look at my latest piece for Judas and the Black Messiah. So I started with adding a star because, you know, I noticed that in the portrayal of Huey P. Newton in one of his posters, and as well as the revised Marcus Garvey flag. So when I was starting the project, I really wanted to make sure that I did as much research and gathered as much factual information as possible. I wanted it to be a nod to the late 50s and 60s and 70s and that artwork era, but I also wanted to create my own world within the artwork. A supreme inspiration for this piece was Emory Douglas, who served as the Minister of Culture for the Black Panther Party for several years and is responsible for majority, if not all, of the artwork that was birthed from that era. I wanted to tribute his design style by merging our two worlds. He was very, he was known for using a lot of cutouts and texture and sketch to create the artwork that is just legendary within our understanding of this era in history. And I wanted to tribute him by creating a piece that felt as if it were using a number of mediums, although it's all digital. I wanted to create that effect. I wanted to include the guys outside of the car because it's indicative of the camaraderie that was maintained within the Black Panther Party. They were people. They were people that were led to, you know, this movement and to create this movement. And I wanted to make sure that camaraderie and that brotherhood, and as well as the sisterhood, was prominent and paramount in this piece. The very first design decision that I made was color. I looked at the Marcus Garvey flag that's commonly associated with the Black Panther Party, and I looked, you know, to the meaning, and the black within the flag is representative of the people, and the red is bloodshed, while the green is the earth. And I wanted it to be incorporated into the design because it felt purposeful and intentional and honest, and it's familiar, you know? That color story is familiar in our culture and our history, and I wanted to make sure that the artwork reflected that. Coolest part about creating this artwork was having the opportunity to use texture in a much different way than I typically do. I use a lot more of it in this work, primarily because in the late 50s and 60s, designers would pull from a catalog. They would, you know, pull textures from a catalog, and they would just call them out, and they would be able to scan full textures and use them in whichever way they wanted to. So I did a lot of digging and researching to find, you know, textures that were used during this era, and I incorporated them all throughout the piece just to add that depth and sense of emotion and connection between the imagery. I wanted it to have its own story within a story, you know? So I felt really powerful being able to kind of call back to that era of design and create something in the full scope. What was more important to me than, you know, design decisions or aesthetically driven decisions like texture and color was the portrayal of these characters as people. I mean, you know, with their own motivations and their own stories and emotion, and their connectivity to each other was important to me. And I didn't want to paint them in a light of struggle or gore or, you know, those kinds of things, because I felt that the supreme story is the people. What they were inspired to do, what they were led to do, their cultural contributions, their stories, that was super important to me. So I wanted to align them in a way where they all felt prominent within the piece. You know, no one character is greater than the next. because they're all integral to this story. I love adding like Easter eggs in my designs. There's part of the design where you see a 1951 police car, as well as a photo booth from that time that were just, you know, sourced from imagery and the actual film and things that I noticed during that time. So I wanted to make sure that every piece of imagery that I used was historically accurate. That is an actual 1951 police car. That is an actual photo booth that was used during that time in a certain scene in the field by Lakeith's character, William O'Neill. And I wanted to make sure that that story was told as well. Every part of this has to lend itself to the story. There's no one detail that isn't important to the overall narrative. The very last design decision that I made, which caused me a lot of complication and just this internal battle, was the decision to incorporate the bullet holes, the two bullet holes, which are representative of those two bullets that were said to have penetrated Chairman Fred's body during the police raid. I thought about it, and I was kind of hesitant toward using it because I was like, I don't want this to be insensitive, and I don't want to, you know, create the kind of negative narrative. But the fact of the matter is, it's the fact of the matter. The truth is that the FBI murdered Fred Hampton, and you can't tell the story and not tell that part of the story. You can't sensationalize the truth. You can't sacrifice the truth because you are, you know, afraid as an artist of creating some kind of backlash or trauma when it comes to the tragedy. But the fact is, that's a part of the story. And so, you know, after much debate and even a couple friends lending some perspective to me, I, you know, incorporated it, and I feel very good about it because now I understand that the truth should always reign supreme in any creative work. And I'm thankful that this piece can serve as a testament to that lesson.